Now we know. We think we know what happened in 1972. But we know only what we can prove. The tip of the iceberg. How much deeper does the ice run? And how much darker? What do we know about 1968? And about 1963? There are those who know, or say they do. The officials, those in power. And usually they want to stay where they are. They act as though truth was their own private property and everybody else was condemned either to err or to trespass. They are the self-righteous kings and barons of modern tragedies, and the crusading knights are the journalists.
Los Angeles District Attorney Joseph P. Bush.
During the past 4 months, I took the unusual action of completely reviewing the evidence of a murder which was committed 3.5 years ago before the eyes of many people. I took this step as district attorney because of the special nature of this event as a stifling public tragedy. A measure of its impact is the continuing and fruitless search by many persons to find a more rational basis for this senseless act.
You got all those people, see the man pull the trigger, and we wasted that many millions of dollars carrying on a ludicrous trial.
We should spend another $600,000 if there's any doubt whatsoever that that man is guilty.
This chorus of pros and cons is the people, you and me, the heartbeat of a democracy. We are all America has. The decision is ours. Whether we can periodically let a few ounces of lead vote for a whole nation.
No one, no matter where he lives or what he does, can be certain who next will suffer from some senseless act of bloodshed. And yet it goes on and on and on in this country of ours. Why?
The Los Angeles Sports Arena was the scene of Robert Kennedy's first great triumph. As campaign manager, he delivered to his brother John the Democratic presidential nomination, and the new frontier was born. 8 years later, just 4 miles away at the Ambassador Hotel, Los Angeles is auspicious again, and Bobby wins the important California primary. The White House is now in sight, but the long, arduous road passes through this dark kitchen pantry.
Anybody could have got in.
Like you said, anybody could have got in, you know.
Yeah, security was really bad, lousy, you know. There was a press room, that's what it's called, and I was walking in there, and there was a bag full of passes. It says embassy room passes. So I walked in there, and I put my hand in there, and I took about 8 of them. And then I went out, you know, and then I gave them all to my friends. You know, I gave it to a guy named Brent Gold, Scott Inyart.
A friend of ours got passes. We thought, you know, it would be fun. We could get some pictures. So that's why we came.
How long have you worked with a professional camera, Scott?
I had been using a camera for about 2 years prior to what happened here.
These are the prints the police gave you after the trial, the Sirhan trial.
That's correct. I feel there are some missing from it. I took a 36 exposure roll, and I got 26 prints back.
Mayor Yorty has just sent me a message that we've been here too long already. So, my thanks to all of you, and now it's on to Chicago, and let's win there.
Delegate votes go.
It just goes back to struggle.
I know where he's coming. I've been with him long enough. I know what your name is, but thanks a lot.
and Kennedy has been shot. They think Kennedy has been shot. It appeared to be gunshot. Seems like Robert Kennedy has been shot. In a little room off to the side. I was near the senator. He heard what appeared to be gunshot coming from inside this room in here. It was mass chaos. You heard it as it happened. We don't know what has happened. It's mass chaos. Oh, someone else was shot. Someone else was shot. We have another person who was next to Kennedy who was shot in the forehead. She is bleeding badly. Another person was shot near Kennedy. It's mass chaos here. We did hear gunfire from in the hallway. There are people running everywhere.
He's all right.
You sure? Another lady was shot in the forehead.
The photos we just saw were taken by Scott Enyart. Approximately 10 frames are missing from the set. Scott Enyart explains why.
As soon as I got out the door, I was surrounded by about 6 policemen with their guns drawn. And they placed me in a car, took my camera from me, and told me that it was evidence and that they would have to have the film. They finally questioned me around 5:30, gave my camera back without the film. And I asked them about when I would get my film back, and they told me that they'd contact me. They didn't contact me, and about 6 months later, I started asking, you know. I called them, went down there, and asked them about, you know, having the rights to my own film. And they disavowed any knowledge of even knowing me. And finally, my father talked to his attorney, who located some people downtown. And about a year after I had taken them, I finally got a number of prints back, which I consider an incomplete set.
Did they give you negatives?
No, they gave me no film, and they told me that they would give me the film when they could, and they would contact me. I've contacted them, and they know nothing about me.
California Attorney General Evel J. Younger, formerly Los Angeles District Attorney, who prosecuted Sirhan, interviewed by KHJ-TV's Nikki Pierce.
I said that when we first started this investigation, you were a little girl at the time, but I said that we've interviewed 4,000 people, and we've done it because someday, somebody, for purposes best known to themselves, regardless of the evidence, is going to try to prove that Sirhan didn't do it, that this was a conspiracy, that this is some big mysterious plan that in spite of all the investigation we haven't been able to uncover. We knew it would happen.
Los Angeles Police Department Chief Edward M. Davis.
Now this was obviously an open and shut case right from the beginning with all of the witnesses and the physical evidence, and I don't think it probably could have been handled in any better fashion than it really was.
We knew that books would be written. We knew that people would try to become famous or make a fortune on the basis of some new and varied theory as to what happened in the Sirhan case.
And there are many authors and of theories and authors of books, and there are still people trying to get rich over the tragedy of the Kennedys.
Ironically, the first detailed book on the assassination, Special Unit Senator, was written by the man responsible for the official investigation, Robert A. Houghton, Chief of Detectives, Los Angeles Police Department. Quote, for the sole purpose of acquainting the American public with the facts of the investigation and with the evidence. Unquote. Houghton seemed haunted by the local ineptitude and the shameful bungling of Dallas. He told his top aide, Captain Hugh Brown, I want this investigation to stand up to whatever scrutiny, as much fine comb study as it's going to get. And Brown knew from experience, Houghton added, that it was going to be raked over, re-raked, and raked again. If anyone lived up to Chief Houghton's nightmare, it is investigative reporter Theodore Chirac. Chirac had spent nearly 3 years probing the case when on May 21, 1971, he disclosed his preliminary findings to a group of concerned citizens, which included Stephen Reinhart, the Democratic National Committee man from California, and Jess Unruh, chairman of the 1968 Kennedy delegation from California, a close friend of the Kennedy family, and an official eyewitness to the case. The first results of the investigation were reported by Los Angeles Mayor Sam Yorty himself. To a world numbed by the tragedy, he declared,
we know, of course, who committed the crime. His name appears to be Sirhan, S-A-R-H-A-N, Sirhan.
The image of Los Angeles was whitewashed, but in the process, Sirhan's presumption of innocence, guaranteed by law, suffered considerably. As the investigation progressed, a number of witnesses questioned the investigators' objectivity, especially with regard to the possible involvement of co-conspirators. Reporter Ted Chirac first recorded the complaints of the owners of the gun shop where Sirhan bought his ammunition, Ben and Donna Herrick.
I gave a statement to the FBI and the Los Angeles Police Department that Sirhan and two others had been in here about 6 weeks before. That they asked for some 357 armor-piercing tank ammo. We didn't have it for sale.
That's right. And they didn't even want her to testify because she wouldn't change her story.
Their former clerk, Larry Arnott, who actually made the sale, was impeached when he testified that Sirhan was with two other men.
I like the Arnott testimony, asking him if he sold the ammunition. He said yes, and then they said he failed a lie detector test, and they have him identify the sales slip. And the sales slip definitely proves the fact that he was telling the truth, and they say the lie detector says he said he was telling a lie and then throwing him off the witness stand, you know, like... It just discredited the man's testimony and made a fool out of him. And for no reason, because he was a prosecution witness to begin with. And it was the prosecution that did it to him, you know. I don't like the smell of it.
Official eyewitnesses Booker Griffin and Richard Lubick also tell of their experiences.
I was very unhappy with my encounter with the police department when I went down to the administration building. I was very much struck by their desire to fabricate a story and by their effort to strong-arm me mentally into stating that there were things that I did not agree with.
I think the Los Angeles police don't have anything to worry about. They got a man that shot Kennedy. That's all they have to worry about. All their evidence points, they've got witnesses, eyewitnesses that saw Sirhan pull the trigger. That's all they're interested in. And I think that there's more to this story than will ever be known, and I think it will be hushed up. America's been shot down.
Realtor George Green and journalist Booker Griffin were not together at the Ambassador Hotel, but they tell the same story.
I saw Sirhan and a lady and another gentleman consistently throughout the evening. There was a girl in a black and white dress involved with Sirhan.
She was tall, statuesque, black hair, well built. I did notice that. I remember that she had on a polka dot dress.
At the trial, to everyone's astonishment, the prosecution produced co-ed Valerie Schulte as the polka dot girl. Aside from the fact that Miss Schulte's polka dots were the wrong color, she walked with a crutch, which none of the witnesses seemed to have noticed in the pantry. Booker Griffin cannot possibly accept Valerie Schulte as the girl he saw run away from the scene of the crime.
Unalterably and impossibly, it is not the same person. The Schulte girl is a high Nordic type who's highly Anglo. The girl that I saw was a swarthy type, Mediterranean type. Her hair was dark, very dark. It was not blonde in any manner. And she did not have the clean-cut, vivacious look of this Schulte girl.
Investigative journalist Fernando Fora recalls the content of the tape he gave to the police.
The man that I interviewed on that tape was named John Fehi. He claims to have spent the day with a girl who later became known as the girl in the polka dot dress. This girl predicted the killing of Senator Kennedy not only as to the date, but to the exact occasion on which it would occur. A team of investigators composed of Jordan Bonfanti, bureau chief for Life magazine in Los Angeles, and myself set out to verify the story of John Fehi. We were fortunate enough to be able to confirm an important portions of that story. We further went on and gave the man a polygraph test, a lie detector test, on which the man passed with flying colors.
Some people who are interested in undermining confidence in the government of the United States, subversive people, will say this is some kind of a plot and so forth. And we anticipated all of this in advance.
The fact is that a girl was seen with Sirhan and the police could not find her.
These things are never really settled, any of these big murder cases. They're still arguing about maybe somebody else shot Abraham Lincoln. So no matter who it is or how long, it still goes on and on and on. And I suppose this is another case that's going to be like that.
Another unusual side of the Sirhan case is the occult part, championed by author Robert Blair Kaiser. Like the hero of Richard Condon's novel, The Manchurian Candidate, could Sirhan be brainwashed and programmed to commit political assassination? Dr. Bernard Diamond for the defense and Dr. Seymour Pollock for the prosecution, put Sirhan under hypnosis in an attempt to help him remember consciously the scene of the assassination.
And you see Kennedy coming. Now, what do you see, Sirhan? You're back in the kitchen now. What do you see? Sirhan. What's he doing here? What? That son of a bitch. You son of a bitch. You're talking to Kennedy. That son of a bitch has been verified by witness.
I heard the words, Kennedy, you son of a bitch, and then the shots went off.
Look at Kennedy. He's coming. Reach for your gun, Sirhan. It's your last chance, Sirhan. Reach for your gun. Where is your gun? Where is your gun? Reach for it. Reach for it, Sirhan. Reach for your gun. Reach for your gun. Sirhan, take the gun out and shoot it. Who are you shooting, Sirhan? Who are you shooting? His fingers are going to repetitive spasmodic movements like pulling a trigger and a double action revolver.
I asked him, I said, son, will you tell me why did you do that? His tears began to drop. He said, Mama, I'm sorry. I don't remember anything. I did not do it. I was told that I killed Senator Robert Kennedy.
Sam. You're shooting Kennedy now, huh? The double-action gun is hard to pull the trigger, huh?
Sirhan, you had wanted to remember the shooting of Kennedy. You wanted to remember your shooting him. Now you'll remember shooting him. You'll remember taking the gun out, pulling the trigger again and again and again. You'll remember all of this. You'll remember all of it. All of this will get clearer and clearer, become clearer and clearer, and you'll remember all of it.
Now Sirhan is awakened from his hypnotic sleep.
Do you remember where you told us where the gun was? Well, remember, you told me where the gun is. Show me on, point to me where the gun was. 5 minutes ago, Sirhan, you showed me where the gun was. Now point to me where the gun was. The gun was right here, huh? Right there in your belt. You reached for the gun. You showed us, sir, how you reached for the gun. Go ahead, reach for it. Yes, just the gun you reached. You showed us how. You reached in there, and you showed us how you pulled the trigger. Try to remember.
In spite of all this hypnotic and post-hypnotic coaching, which in court would certainly be called leading the witness, Sirhan still does not remember anything.
Dr. Sheldon H. Cardner, Associate Clinical Professor of Psychiatry at the University of California at Los Angeles, comments.
It's extremely important, particularly when using hypnosis to elicit information from an individual, to permit them to spontaneously express that which they feel under hypnosis is most important to them. From the portion of tape we've heard, one does not get that impression. It is disconcerting in that it would seem more to be as though a script were written, staging were being conducted, and Sirhan seemed to have been auditioned for a part in this particular script.
The senior psychologist of the San Quentin State Prison, Dr. Edward Simpson, examined Sirhan 20 weeks in a row. His visits were abruptly terminated by San Quentin's associate warden, James Park. In an affidavit written in behalf of Sirhan, Dr. Simpson concluded, "A close study of the trial testimony and my own extensive study of Sirhan leads to the irrevocable and obvious conclusion. Sirhan's trial was and will be remembered as the psychiatric blunder of the century." Perhaps the most dramatic observation of Dr. Simpson is that the handwriting of Sirhan in his notebooks differs often drastically from the handwriting on numerous test materials he obtained from Sirhan at San Quentin. About the evidence a juror described as most damaging, Dr. Simpson concludes, "I strongly suspect the notebooks are a forgery, for the thinking reflected is foreign to the Sirhan I carefully studied."
I'm Dr. Thomas T. Noguchi, the chief Los Angeles County medical examiner and coroner. Dr. Noguchi, how many gunshot wounds did Senator Kennedy sustain?
The autopsy findings revealed that there were 3 gunshot wounds.
A 4th shot passed harmlessly through the right shoulder pad of the senator's jacket. These 4 shots raised a problem which could not be solved by Prosecutor David Fitz without creating a serious discrepancy in the actual testimony.
Former Ambassador Hotel Assistant Maitre D. Carl Euchre, who was leading Kennedy and stopped Sirhan, was the star witness.
David Fitz has told the jury that you reacted after the 4th shot.
No, I don't believe that. You know, from the first time, right, the police investigated it, I said after the 2nd shot, and I know it.
Are we to believe the prosecutor, who was not in the pantry, or the prosecution's own star witness?
Sirhan then was shooting blindly after the 2nd shot.
Oh, yes, blindly. Yes. He just was pulling the trigger. I even could feel when his hand was moving and pulling him, but he didn't see anything anymore where he was shooting because I had him complete covered with my, with the headlight.
How far was Senator Robert Kennedy from Sirhan and yourself, Carl?
Kennedy was as far as I can reach my left hand here when I had his hand, and he had his hand like this when I had his hand, you know? So it was quite away from Sirhan. And Sirhan was right in front of me, right in front of the steam table and between me.
In front,
yeah. I had him right in front of me. I didn't let him pass me. I had my left foot on his knees, and now you pushed him over.
How far would the gun muzzle be from Senator Kennedy's head?
About a foot and a half, I would say, foot and a half, 2 feet.
Dr. Noguchi, were you able to determine how far the gun muzzle was from Senator Kennedy's head?
A gunshot wound was found behind the right ear, and there were abundance of a powder deposit on the edge of the right ear, and after test firing the similar weapon, we came to conclusion that the muzzle distance would be 1 inch from the right ear edge and no more than 3 inches.
How did your office resolve some of the discrepancies in that trial between the medical reports, for instance, that Kennedy was killed by a gun 1 inch from him, and the eyewitness reports of Sirhan's position 3 feet away?
Oh, I don't think there were any major discrepancies. Certainly the jury didn't think so.
Will we create what happened inside the kitchen pantry, Carl, at the moment of the 1st shots?
Yeah.
I'll play the role of Senator Robert Kennedy, and Michael Reed will assume Sirhan's part. What did take place?
We start going through the doors. I'm leading Senator Kennedy, more or less holding him on his ankle like this, leading him towards the kitchen, which leads towards the colonial room. And when we came behind the doors, he starts shaking hands with some of the helpers and some of the hotel staff. And our last stop was at the ice machine, right across from the ice machine where we have the steam tables. And Senator Kennedy did shake hands with one of the bus boys, and I think he was the last one he shook hands with. And so I took Senator Kennedy's hand again and said, Senator, we have to go. And
Senator's hand was back in your hand, Carl.
Yeah, his right hand I got with my left hand.
Mm-hmm.
It's like this.
Mm-hmm.
I got his hand right here, and he's saying, Senator, we have to go now. But this time he was still talking towards the bus boy, and he starts looking at me, and we start going. At the same time was when somebody moved into me between the steam table,
mm-hmm,
and myself. You know, I was maybe was 1 foot in between the steam table and myself. So here he comes, Sirhan, moving into me.
He can't send the bomber. You're not going to let him, are you, Sirhan?
Where's Sirhan? Just go around to me slowly, and here I push him away. No, just go, move right into it. Here, I got him right here. pressed him against the steam table because I thought he was one of the helpers of the hotel, and I didn't want him to stop us again to shake hands. But that time, I heard one shot, and I thought it was a firecracker or something. Monsieur Hahn is right in front of me here, turned this way, and this hand I actually didn't see no more. And I had Kennedy by the hand, and I heard the second shot going off, and then I realized I saw that gun here somewhere around here, you know? Somewhere around here, and I guess at the time when I lose Kennedy's hand, and I just dropped his hand and I pushed it.
I saw, just falling to the ground, Senator Kennedy, and blood was already oozing out of his head, and it was going over the floor. It was horrible.
I was very lucky that I got him right here on his ankle. Oh, that was my luck, otherwise I wouldn't be here today anymore. So I pushed him down and put him over the steam table, and here Sirhan keeps on pulling him to the left side, and that's when he starts shooting very rapidly, the last shots. Now, that time I had him like this, you know, and I was hitting that gun on top of the steam table.
Dr. Noguchi, could you determine the direction of the fatal wound to the head?
Well, the gunshot wound through the right mastoid behind the right ear. It showed the direction to be upward, back to front, and of course to the right to left direction. So if I may just use my finger to illustrate, it will be like this.
Carl, this is a very critical question to the case. Was it possible that Sirhan could have fired the fatal shot before you had a chance to grab him?
If the bullet killed him, which was shot about 2 feet away from his head, yes. But if the bullet, which the autopsy said from Dr. Noguchi, that the bullet must have been about 1 to 3 inches away from his head, no. Sirhan never came that close to Kennedy.
Do you have a witness that supports your testimony?
Yes, it is Eddie Manassian, which was right behind me.
Manassian testified at the grand jury that Sirhan's gun was approximately 3 feet away from the senator. He heard 2 very deliberate shots, then a slight pause, which gave Euchre a chance to intervene.
There were 2 additional gunshot wounds found in the senator's remains. The 2 were very close together. Gunshot wound number 2 was found in the armpit, and it was a through and through gunshot wound, and the direction was back to front, and the exit wound was found front of the right shoulder.
Was it possible for Sirhan to get behind you and behind Senator Kennedy and shoot from behind?
No, this was complete impossible, because Sirhan was in front of me, and he didn't have no way to go behind me, to come behind me, to shoot from behind me.
You're sure?
I'm 100% sure, yes. Oh, yes. I had the gun after the second shot. I had his hand with the gun in complete possession.
Wasn't there a discrepancy about the position of Sirhan? There was a shot fired from behind Senator Kennedy, and witnesses said that he was never behind Senator Kennedy.
Well, a discrepancy. If somebody says 1 inch and somebody else says 2 inches, that's a discrepancy. But the jury didn't think it was a significant discrepancy, and neither did I.
For the record, the discrepancy is not between 1 inch and 2 inches, but between 1 inch and 2 feet.
What worries me more than a discrepancy in a criminal trial is where you've got all of the witnesses saying exactly the same thing. That's when you have to worry, not when there's a reasonable discrepancy.
Dr. Noguchi, would you tell us about the powder burns? Would it be possible to get powder burns if the gun was 2 or 3 feet away from Senator Kennedy?
In this case, of course, the abundance of a powder burn embedded deep in the tissue, it is scientifically highly unlikely.
At the trial, Dr. Noguchi never had the opportunity to elaborate on his astounding findings. His testimony was cut short. In fact, soon after, Dr. Noguchi was fired and accused of being derelict in his performance of the Robert Kennedy autopsy. Attorney Godfrey Isaac defended him.
Well, the first question that I ask of a witness with reference to showing what a competent and really extraordinary autopsy Dr. Noguchi performed, The deputy county counsel asked to approach the commissioners, and there stated that if I went into the questioning further, that it would cause an international incident. I pointed out that what I was going to show would cause no international incident because Dr. Noguchi performed what has been described as the most perfect autopsy in history.
Now, what was meant by international repercussions on that day with regards to Senator Robert F. Kennedy's autopsy?
Well, Deputy County Counsel Martin Weeks did not define what he meant by that, but he seemed to indicate that it would cast a great deal of doubt on what we'd heard about Robert Kennedy's death.
The headlines at the time said that there was a mystery to the Robert Kennedy autopsy.
Well, a paradox that's never been explained is how the Los Angeles County, through the district attorney's office, could base a murder charge on the autopsy of Dr. Noguchi, and then in the hearing relative to his firing, tried to take the same autopsy to show that he should be fired. As a matter of fact, I don't think this is something that can be explained, and I think that anyone who reasons and thinks would be naive not to feel there might be some connection in with regard to assassinations and what occurred.
But when there are witnesses that said Sirhan never got behind Senator Kennedy, and then there are medical reports saying he was shot from behind, isn't that a significant discrepancy?
Well, as I say, you apparently want all the witnesses, or would prefer to have all the witnesses sound like they'd memorized their testimony. I wouldn't. There was no significant discrepancy. Now, you and I are just arguing now. You apparently think there was a significant discrepancy. And if we stay here for 4 hours, I do not think I will conclude there was a significant discrepancy in the testimony.
Okay.
How far would the gun possibly be from Senator Kennedy's head?
About a foot and a half, I would say a foot and a half, 2 feet.
We came to conclusion that the muzzle distance would be 1 inch from the right ear edge and no more than 3 inches.
Sirhan never came that close to Kennedy.
You saw Dr. Noguchi demonstrate that the fatal shot was fired as close as 1 inch behind the right ear of the senator, as represented on this reconstitution.
Unlike Sirhan's gun, the .22 caliber revolver used here has a long barrel to show more clearly the actual angles of the wound paths.
You saw Carl Uecker demonstrate that the gun muzzle was approximately 2 feet in front of the senator, as shown on this scale model. In fact, not a single eyewitness placed the gun any closer. Like Manassian, busboy Juan Romero said the gun was 3 feet away, and New York Post writer Pete Hamill told the FBI he saw Sirhan standing in front of and to Senator Kennedy's left, about 7 or 8 feet, with his arm fully extended and his face in tremendous concentration, shooting a gun at Senator Kennedy.
The official explanation for the back-to-front wounds is that the testimony at the grand jury and trial placed the senator looking slightly to his left.
The accuracy of this police statement can be disputed, but for the sake of discussion, let us assume it is entirely correct.
This three-dimensional model now shows the position of Senator Kennedy as it is represented by the police trajectory diagram. The second victim to the left is Paul Schrade, and the third is Ira Goldstein. The senator's position clearly suggests that he was still in the process of shaking hands with the kitchen help when he was shot.
The fallacies of this interpretation of the testimony are manifold. One, this would contradict the account of busboy Juan Romero, who, according to Chief Investigator Robert Houghton, was the last person to shake Kennedy's hand. Immediately after the shooting, Romero was quoted by Conrad Kassler of the Los Angeles Herald Examiner as saying, "He was shaking my hand, and I just turned away when this guy came out and started shooting." Two, Kennedy being turned in Romero's direction would also contradict Carl Uecker, who says the same thing as the busboy. Waiter Martin Petruski agrees that Uecker was moving.
He was pulling Kennedy through the kitchen at the time, and he grabbed the guy by the neck.
Three, writer Pete Hamill saw the same thing as Uecker and Romero. He told the FBI, after Kennedy shook hands, he turned to continue walking straight ahead.
But not all witnesses agreed that the senator had already turned back and was facing in Sirhan's direction. Attorney Frank J. Burns testified that Kennedy was still shaking hands in the position shown here.
However, Mr. Burns concedes that he was not actually looking at the senator's head, nor could he see his hands at the exact moment of the shooting, nor did he ever see the gun any closer than 2 feet from Kennedy's head. Four, if the senator was looking in the direction of Romero and away from Sirhan, why then would he lift his right arm in the apparent attempt to protect his face from an assailant he cannot see? Five, the two armpit shots were fired at a very steep angle.
respectively 67 and 59 degrees upward from the horizontal, as if Sirhan was firing from the floor. Since he was never observed in that position, the only other logical alternative permitting Sirhan to create those wounds from behind would be if the senator's body had started to slump forward, like this. Then he would have fallen on his stomach, but actually he fell backwards in an almost totally opposite direction. 6. The bullet which went through Kennedy's armpit and chest was never found in the ceiling where the police trajectory diagram shows it should be. This strongly suggests that the senator was not really in the position shown by the diagram. If we rotate the figurine representing the senator back to the position where he was observed by Carl Euchre, Juan Romero, and Pete Hamill at the time of the shooting, the chest shot and shoulder pad shot now trace to another part of the ceiling. This area is situated directly behind Sirhan's head and completely outside of his line of fire. As can be seen on this picture taken the day after the shooting, it so happens that two ceiling panels are missing from the same area. It so happens that none of the panels removed from the pantry ceiling were introduced as evidence during the trial. Why? It so happens that the entire left sleeve of Senator Kennedy's coat, the left sleeve of his shirt, and left cufflink seem to have been lost during the investigation. If there was only one bullet mark or hole in them, it would prove that Senator Kennedy was not turned to his left when fired at. How can we ever be sure this is not the case, as long as the evidence is missing? Same thing with the two missing ceiling panels. If there are bullet holes in them, then they would prove the existence of another gun firing over Sirhan's head from behind the right side of the senator. Unpleasant as it is nevertheless reasonable to speculate that a contract killer could not find a more efficient and concealed position to do his deed. First, a clear opening to shoot at the heart, with little chance to be seen by witnesses situated either in front of or behind the victim. Then another opportunity for a concealed coup de grace in the back of the head as the victim slumps to the floor.
To develop further his alternate theory of the assassination, Chirac needed to establish at least one other gun in the pantry besides Sirhan's. On a hunch, he asked Carl Euchre.
Did you see any security guards in that kitchen pantry?
There was a security man somewhere behind me. I don't know how far away from me.
On what side?
Somewhere around right on the left side, you know, right behind Kennedy, somewhere around there.
I see. Well, that would be Thane Eugene Caesar, according to an official police diagram.
A few uniformed armed guards were hired by the Ambassador Hotel. One of these guards, Thane Eugene Caesar, a plumber by trade, moonlighting out of the Ace Guard Service, tells about the strange premonition of his colleague, Jack Merritt.
At 8:30, quarter to nine, I remember as long as I live, I was standing at the main door of the ballroom. Jack looks at me and he says, you know, he says, I got a funny feeling there's going to be big trouble here tonight. And I looked at him and I says, why? He says, I just got that feeling. And I just laughed it off as a joke. But maybe he knew something I didn't.
By his own account, recorded in 1969 by Ted Chirac, Caesar is now entering the pantry at Kennedy's side.
For some reason, I don't know why, I had a hold of his arm under his elbow here.
Which arm?
Would be his right arm. And with my left hand, and I was pushing people with my right because there was a lot that was, I would say, way over 100 people in the kitchen area. Who knows how many. And just as we reached the edge of the steam tables, the little Spanish busboy was standing there, and Bobby turned his head at an angle.
Juan Romero.
Right, to reach over, and he started to shake hands with him. And when he did, that's when the shots were fired. And the thing I saw first wasn't so much the noise, but with a flash. I got powder in my eyes from the flash. And I was a little behind Bobby, so I would say I was about 3 feet from the flash, because I looked up and seen the red gun flash. And like I said, I got a little bit of powder in my eyes.
Then Chirac heard what he had hoped to hear.
When the shots were fired, when I reached for my gun, and this one I got knocked down.
Did you get your gun out of your holster?
Yeah, but it didn't do no good because I'm on the floor.
Oh, yeah.
But anyways, I got back up. I had my gun out, but they already had him restrained.
Did you see other guys pull their guns after you pulled your gun that
time? After we went out through the swinging doors, yeah, there was three of us had our guns out.
What about in the kitchen?
No, I didn't see any other body else pull their guns in the kitchen area.
Except yourself?
Except for myself.
And you pulled it the instant you saw them?
When I seen the flashes and the gun go off, I pulled it, but I got knocked down.
How far did you have it out?
Well, I had it out of my holster. I had it in my hand.
In conflicting accounts to the police, the FBI, and the district attorney, Caesar said that he pulled his gun after getting up from the floor. Los Angeles Times reporter Dave Smith remarked that no effort was made to determine whether those variances arose from Caesar's effort to conceal something. Then Chirac asked the two questions the official investigators did not ask till more than 3 years after the assassination.
What caliber gun did you have on you?
38.
38. Is there any chance that that gun could have gone off?
My gun?
Yeah.
The only way it would have come off is I'd have pulled the trigger because the hammer wasn't cocked. It would have taken more pressure. I would have had to want to fire the gun. I mean, I'd have had to. It wouldn't have been something where I'd have slipped on the trigger. It wouldn't have been that easy. You'd have had to put pressure against the trigger and pull it.
I see.
Where if it's cocked, it takes very little to set it off.
Chirac could not believe that not a single eyewitness had noticed Caesar pulling his gun in full view. After combing thousands of pages of testimony and miles upon miles of tapes, Chirac finally came across this startling air check recorded off the CBS television station in Los Angeles the night of the tragedy.
Jerry Dunphy once again back at KNXD election headquarters. Don Shulman, one of our KNXD employees, witnessed the shooting that we've been telling you about. Kennedy was walking toward the kitchen. That was his route out of the ballroom. A man stepped out of a crowd and shot Kennedy. Kennedy's bodyguards fired back. The suspect now in custody at the Ambassador Hotel. Don Shulman of KNXT tells us that Kennedy was shot 3 times.
What is remarkable, besides the fact that this report came within minutes, Sirhan was still at the Ambassador, is Shulman's immediately verifiable accuracy regarding 2 out of the 3 items he reported. 1, a guard did pull his gun, and 2, Kennedy was shot 3 times. In fact, Shulman was the only witness 100% positive and correct on both counts. Even Kennedy's press secretary, Frank Mankiewicz, said that Kennedy had been shot 2 times, and the press quoted Mankiewicz until the autopsy proved him wrong. On the 3rd item, a guard or guards firing back, Chirac had to find Don Shulman and interview him.
I was in the pantryway following the senator. He stopped and shook hands with several people and started to progress again. We were packed in there like sardines. There were lights and cameras and people and a lot of excitement. Senator just finished shaking hands with someone, and another man, I think it was the maitre d', walked up and took his hand. As we were slowly pushed forward, another man stepped out and he shot. Just then the guard, who was standing behind Kennedy, took out his gun, and he fired also. The next thing I knew is that Kennedy was shot 3 times.
Now, how far was Sirhan from Senator Kennedy at the time?
I would say approximately from 3 to 6 feet.
Where was this guard who was firing his gun?
He was standing directly to the side and back of Kennedy.
On what side?
He was standing on the right-hand side.
Now, Don, did you tell this story to any police authorities?
I told the story to several different people, including several police authorities. Right after it happened, I insisted the senator was shot 3 times. I was told by the police.
Which police?
Well, I was told by the FBI that the... I was told by the FBI, my own news people, that I was mistaken, that I was wrong. The senator was only shot 2 times.
Now, when you say your own news people, who do you mean?
Well, I was on the air with Jerry Dunphy. Also, I did a tape recording with Jeff Brent and several people I told. In fact, I also told them that the guard pulled out the gun, and everyone told me that in the confusion, I didn't see what I saw. Well, I didn't see everything that happened that night because of the blinding lights and the people screaming, but the things that I did see, I'm sure about, and that is Kennedy being shot 3 times. The guard definitely pulled out his gun and fired.
Now, when you say Jeff Brent, he is with the Continental News Service. When did he interview you?
Well, right after the assassination attempt and all the confusion, I fought my way out of the pantry, and I was heading towards a telephone to call CBS News. Before I picked up the phone, Jeff Brent, who grabbed me and asked me right on the spot exactly what I had seen then, fresh in my mind.
I was about 6 people behind the senator. I heard about 6 or 7 shots in succession. Now, is this the security guard firing back?
Yes, the man who stepped out fired 3 times at Kennedy, hit him all 3 times, and the security guards then fired back.
Then the tape we played is authentic.
It is. It was given approximately, well, I'd say 10 to 15 minutes after all the incidents of the evening.
Now, I'm showing you this story. Can you identify it for us? It's a lead story in the Boston Record American. It's dated June the 5th, 1968.
Yes, this was sent to me by the newspaper, and the account, which is in the paper, was the same account I was telling everyone else of the senator being shot three times and of the guard firing.
Did the Los Angeles Police Department, the Special Unit Senator, ever conduct a face-to-face taped or written interview with you?
They did contact me at CBS, as they did everyone else, but as soon as I told them what I told you earlier, they weren't interested in me.
My wife, Rowena, who acted as my legal aide throughout the hearing, which, as you know, resulted in Dr. Noguchi's being completely cleared of all the charges and reinstated as coroner, received a call from a lady who, in fact, made an appointment to come to our home and who wanted to speak with us because she had been at the ambassador that night and she herself had seen a security guard firing.
The lady did not show up, and it was impossible to trace her and verify her story. But there was one easy way to check out Shulman's account, simply to test Caesar's gun to determine whether or not it had been fired. This was not done. Instead, the investigators forgot Shulman's account, and 2 years later, KNXT would profess to know nothing of their own broadcast of Shulman's story.
Tonight, big newsman Carl George presents a report. We checked videotapes recorded the night of the assassination. Shulman made no reference to having seen a security guard draw and shoot his gun from a position on the floor. In fact, Shulman specifically ignores that point in his chronology. Shulman does not say that he saw a guard or guards fire guns. He does not say it until 2 years later.
Foreign correspondent Gerard Alcan can hardly forget. He was on the air from Northern Europe to Mid-Africa on Europe Number One radio. Suddenly, tens of millions heard this.
D'autre part, Alcan,
en ce qui concerne les agresseurs, ici à Paris, d'après les informations que nous transmettent les agences de presse,
oui?
On dit qu'il y en aurait deux.
From Paris, my anchorman was giving me this startling piece of news. Here in Paris, according to the wire services report, there would be two assailants. My answer, one. At this time, only one.
Un seul. Pour l'instant, un seul.
This, I found out later, was an outgrowth of the Shulman story. But François, the largest French newspaper, came out with a straight Shulman version with a dash of Americana. A man is reported to fire, and then, I quote, a Kennedy bodyguard pulls his gun out of the holster in turn and fires from the hip like in a Western movie.
Of course, this does not prove that Don Shulman is correct, but it corroborates the fact that his report is authentic and not fabricated 2 years later, as suggested in KNXT's follow-up story.
As a matter of fact, the police file I-1073 acknowledges Shulman's report as early as July 1968. Nevertheless, a police board of inquiry will suggest 3 years later that Shulman was not in the pantry at the time of the shooting.
If there's anything more to this, some of these witnesses may not live to testify again. I don't know how many people want to say this, but I am afraid.
They wrote me a very, very long and terrible letter that my son's going to be killed in the street one day, and they threatened, a real threatened letter, you know, which I give over to the FBI.
A loud critic of Shulman's story and of Chirac's probe in general is writer Robert Blair Kaiser, author of RFK Must Die. During a program over KPFK radio in Los Angeles, a listener called in and put Kaiser on the defensive about the security guard.
What gun was he carrying? Did anybody bother to check?
Well, the guard says he had a 38 with him that night.
But nobody verified that.
I'm not too sure that the police ever took that gun into custody or anything of the sort. So I think Mr. Chirac probably has a good point there, that was something that the police did overlook.
That's an incredible thing to overlook.
The police investigators who failed to check all the guns in the pantry apparently looked more carefully into the political leanings of all those present. In the conclusion of his book, Chief of Detectives Houghton reports,
on July the 16th, 1969, I held a final special unit senator meeting, asking 10 last questions, which range from the Valley Arabs to the identification of Arabs who sat in on the trial, to the absolute possibility of any person with right-wing connections being in the kitchen or the pantry the night of June the 4th and 5th, 1968. Within a week, all the questions had been answered satisfactorily.
Less than 3 months after Houghton's unsuccessful search for a right-winger in the pantry, security guard Thane Eugene Caesar was telling reporter Ted Chirac,
I definitely wouldn't have voted for Bobby Kennedy because he had the same ideas as John did, and I think John sold the country down the road. He gave it to the commies. He gave it to whoever she wanted to. He literally gave it to the minority.
Again, there are variances between Caesar's answers to the DA and to Chirac.
I'm not a Democrat.
Oh. Yeah.
So it had nothing to do with that. I was going down there just for the money.
Now, who did you vote for in November?
Wallace.
Pardon me?
George Wallace.
Have you worked actively in the third party?
I did over in Simi when I was living in Simi Valley. I worked for George Wallace Party.
Prior to June the 5th?
Mm-hmm.
What did you do exactly?
Oh, I pass handbills and get donations. That's not too much. I didn't have too much time to put into it, but I did put a little bit of time in it.
Did he admit to you that he had worked for George Wallace in 1968?
No. He gave $3, I think, to somebody that he knew that was working for Wallace's campaign. That was the extent of his involvement.
The people in Europe, I don't care where you go, hate our guts.
They do?
They hate us. They'd like to stick a knife in our back. I want to know why? Because they're tired of us giving them everything. They've had it crammed down their throat for so many years, just like the black man. The black man now for the last 4 to 8 years has been cramming this integrated idea down our throat, and so you've learned to hate them. And one of these days, at the rate they're going, there's going to be a civil war in this country. It's going to be the white against the black, and the only thing I'd say is the black will never win. I mean, me as an individual, I'm fed up. And I know a lot of people that I work with have the same feeling. It's just that we ain't had it shoved down our throat enough, but one of these days it's going to be shoved too far, and then we're going to fight back. First of all, I think the white man's going to try and do it with his voting power, and if they can't do it by getting the right person to straighten the thing up, then he's going to take it in his own hands. I can't see any other way to go.
The long series of coincidences in which armed guard Thane Eugene Caesar was involved was never made public, much less explained. At his request, Caesar was never asked to take the witness stand.
I told him, if it's all possible, just may not be involved.
If a man like Caesar could pull his gun next to Kennedy, and if a man like Houghton knew nothing about it, or did know, but attached no importance to it, then for all we know, there could have been any number of guns in the pantry. To this day, we would know nothing about it, and probably will never know. Physical evidence stands on its own. It cannot perjure itself. This is why, at the trial, Prosecutor David Fitz addressed the court in this manner.
Your Honor has heard Carl Euchre and any number of witnesses who attempted to describe what happened. One witness has put the muzzle of the revolver some 3 or 4 feet from the senator's head. Others have had it at varying ranges. The only way we can clear up whatever ambiguity there may be there and to show the truth is by the testimony of this witness. The man thus introduced was Los Angeles Police Department firearms expert Dwayne A. Wolfer.
4 days after the crime, Wolfer reported his first findings. Of the bullets fired at Kennedy, he said, a fourth shot pierced the right shoulder pad of his coat and proceeded into the ceiling. 1 month later, Wolfer turns in the official police summary of the trajectory study. He then reports, quote, bullet passed through the right shoulder pad of Senator Kennedy's suit coat, never entered his body, and traveled upward, striking victim Schrade in the center of his forehead. More than a year later, Special Unit Senator goes to press. There was ample time to verify all the evidence and to amend what may have seemed confusing to the reader. But no footnote was added to Wolfer's first report. So, we must take it at face value. So here we have a bullet which, without any mention of ricocheting or fragmenting, can both proceed into the ceiling and be recovered from Paul Schrade's head. The case of this ubiquitous bullet could be better explained by theorizing that the ceiling and Schrade's head were penetrated by two different bullets. But then, Sir Hans' eight-shot revolver would have fired nine bullets, to say nothing of an Associated Press photo captioned, "Bullet discovered in a door frame." There is also this other photograph showing two more bullet holes in another door frame. This would bring the total to 12 bullets. Interesting as these deductions may be, nothing can top the controversy and the irony surrounding People's Exhibit 55, which was introduced in this manner by Prosecutor David Fitz.
If the court please, I have an envelope which contains, and I can't read the writing, and it's about time I got glasses, but I haven't done it yet, Chief Defense Counsel Grant Cooper, do you want to borrow mine? Mr. Fitz, I would rather use the eyes of Mr. Wolfer.
As it turned out, the eyes of Mr. Wolfer were not to be trusted either, but this was not discovered until many months after the verdict was rendered.
Under oath, Wolfer testified that the bullet recovered from Senator Kennedy's neck and two others taken from victims Ira Goldstein and William Wiesel were all fired from the same gun. This conclusion was arrived at, Wolfer explained, by firing test shots with Serhan's gun and matching them under a microscope with the better preserved bullets recovered from the victims. This method of identifying a murder weapon by its bullet characteristics is basically as dependable as matching fingerprints.
Except for one thing. The official records show clearly that the test bullets, introduced as People Exhibit 55, were not fired by Sir Hans' gun, but by a second gun. Sir Hans' gun is an Ivor Johnson cadet model with the serial number H53725. The other gun is also an Ivor Johnson, but the serial number, filled in twice in Wolfer's own handwriting on the envelope containing the test bullets, is a very different one. H18602. In other words, the prosecution itself introduced physical evidence of the involvement of a second gun in the assassination, and none of the three defense attorneys, nor Judge Walker, for that matter, noticed anything at all. In fact, the court, at this very moment, made the incredible non sequitur statement that the three bullets in question, quote, were fired from this gun and no other gun. Meaning Sir Hans' gun. Without a ripple, the trial went on, as if it were merely the absurd formality of a cleansing sacrificial ritual. Everybody participated, not only the prosecution and the court, also Chief Defense Counsel for Sir Hans, Grant Cooper himself. He forfeited many times the opportunity of full disclosure and meaningful cross-examination by stipulating, that is, agreeing to just about anything short of the gas chamber for his client. For example, talking about the fatal fragmented bullet while Wolfer is on the witness stand, Cooper declared, "We will stipulate that these fragments did come from Senator Kennedy. We will further stipulate they came from the gun." A few moments later, Wolfer testified about the same bullet. "Because of the damage, I cannot say positively that it was fired from that gun, that is, Sir Hans' gun." At time this, it looked like the burden of proof was on the defense, rather than on the prosecution.
One day, when my son was really, really upset, he was hurt, and he couldn't stand it. He said, he stood in the courtroom, and he said, "Please, Your Honor, I have to say something. I don't want these lawyers to defend me." Because he knew that they are not defending him right. And you know, even the judge, he was so hard. I am so sorry to say this. But he said, "Look here, fellow, you have to sit down and keep quiet, or else I put a mask on your face and I tie you in your chair so you cannot defend yourself." And the next day, my son said, "I'm not going to the courtroom unless I see the judge in his chamber." He didn't give me a chance to talk in the courtroom. After they decide all this, My son was permitted into the chamber of the judge with all the defense and the prosecutors were there. And you know what my son said? It's really sad. He said, Your Honor, I'd rather plead guilty and go to the gas chamber than to have you say that you gave me a fair trial and yet send me to the gas chamber. My son did not have a fair trial. He did not have any defense at all.
If Mary Sirhan is correct, it is interesting to note here a troubling parallel. Because of a deficient defense, the state of California apparently did not have to prove the crux of its case against Sirhan any more than the state of Texas against Lee Harvey Oswald, who was assassinated, or the state of Tennessee, which never tried James Earl Ray.
And so a great many facts never saw the light of day. But we have now established this much about the Sirhan case. At the time of the shooting, two guns were drawn, Sirhan's and Caesar's. Caesar's gun was never tested, nor even examined. We do not know scientifically whether or not it was fired. We have Caesar's word that it was a 38 and that it was not fired. But we also have Don Schulman's word that a security guard fired his gun in the pantry. In the courtroom, evidence was introduced about two guns, Sirhan's and the other 22 Ivor Johnson, recorded in Los Angeles Police Department Officer Wolfer's handwriting as having fired the test bullets. Incredibly, this second gun was destroyed by the Los Angeles Police Department. In November 1970, the state records show that this gun had been destroyed in July 1968, prior to the trial.
On October 11, 1971, this information was declared erroneous by the Los Angeles Police Department Board of Inquiry investigating Mr. Wolfer's performance. The record was corrected to reflect that the test gun was actually destroyed in July 1969.
One way or another, the only gun technically linked to the pantry shooting by Mr. Wolfer's handwriting and testimony is now destroyed.
Attorney Barbara Blair threw the whole thing into the open. She was trying to block Mr. Wolfer's appointment as chief forensic chemist of the Los Angeles Police Department on grounds that he violated proper ballistics procedures. Los Angeles District Attorney Joseph Bush announced the matter would be settled in 2 weeks. Nearly 5 months later, on October 18, 1971, he had this to say.
We have reached the conclusion that the charges made against Mr. Wolfer are untrue. Our findings show he did not violate proper ballistics procedures in the Sirhan trial. The investigation revealed only that Mr. Wolfer made a clerical error in labeling the trial exhibit envelope containing three bullets test fired by him from the gun wrenched out of Sirhan's hand at the assassination scene.
Here are excerpts of District Attorney Bush's confrontation with newsmen.
Was Mr. Wolfer given a lie detector test by you or the police during this investigation?
He was not given a lie detector by us.
Why?
Well, I don't believe it would be necessary. The allegations as they now stand have arisen about 2.5 years after the fact. There's never been any question about this. There's never been any impugning of the integrity or that there was any ever firing. There is no evidence except for the fact that there was a mislabeled envelope, that there could possibly have been a mistake.
But the man's integrity is being challenged publicly, and there are some, what are considered some fairly strong arguments against. Now, if you're going to submit an equally strong argument for your defense, wouldn't it involve a lie detector test at the very least?
Well, I wouldn't subject Wolfer to a lie detector test based on what we have discovered as a result of our investigation. I don't see any credence in this at all.
On page 118 of the Special Unit Senator book, Chief Houghton says that the sound level tests were held on June 20th, and he says, quote, Sirhan's gun was fired with the same caliber of mini-mag ammunition at approximately the spot where Kennedy fell unquote.
That's not true.
Mr. Houghton's book is inaccurate?
That's right.
Is it inaccurate in other respects, too?
I have no idea, but that statement is not correct. Rather than take the gun out of evidence that had been introduced on the 7th of June, just 2 days after the killing, another gun was used of a similar make and manufacture.
Is it not regular procedure to use the murder weapon for any and all tests when it's possible?
If possible, yes, it is. In this instance, it was our judgment that it was better to leave the murder weapon in the custody of the county clerk as a grand jury exhibit.
What would have been required to get that gun released?
A court order.
Was a court order sought?
No.
A former judge and FBI agent, university professor of law, and a prominent expert in legal medicine, Marshall Houts, wrote in a personal letter to Attorney General Evel Younger, "I have a deep academic and professional concern over Wolfer's horrendous blunders in the past and those he will commit in the future if he continues on his present assignment. Wolfer suffers from a great inferiority complex for which he compensates by giving the police exactly what they need to obtain a conviction. The problems of this philosophy are many and grave, not the least of which is that the prosecutor is led down the primrose path to chagrin and embarrassment when the follies of the charlatan are subsequently uncovered." Marshall Houts, author of many legal books, among others The Rules of Evidence, went on to say, "Real experts of integrity who have examined portions or all of the evidence are appalled at what Wolfer did."
Would it be possible to arrange a simple retest firing of the Sirhan gun to clear up some of these arguments?
I presume that that's something that Mr. Bush, the district attorney, is considering.
Do you think it'd be a good idea?
I won't tell him what to do. It's his problem now. I've got my own.
Mr. Bush, are there any plans at this time to fire the murder weapon and take new jet bullets?
No, there is not.
But you are taking Mr. Wolford's word on this, that he mislabeled that. How can you do this in good conscience without another ballistics test?
Wouldn't this put an end to all this speculation if you refired the gun?
Well, I don't think you're ever going to put an end to the people that want to have a two-gun theory. You'll never put an end to it.
Some of the pro-conspiracy clan who gather around like vultures around any kind of a situation like this attack Mr. Wolfer because Mr. Wolfer's evidence, you see, doesn't give substance to the conspiracy theory.
The attack that is being made at a time when we already know all, under oath, and all of the procedures and all the things that occurred. So that the attack, and this is just, again, as I say, people who are trying to make something out of nothing, to reopen and to start something on the basis of a mismarked envelope. And that is insufficient evidence.
Officials always make little errors. They do not lie.
Totally independent of the controversy around Exhibit 55 is the fact that, of course, Sirhan's gun was placed in the pantry by numerous eyewitnesses. But none of them actually saw Sirhan's gun at contact range.
This should be a traumatic experience, easy to remember. All the witnesses looking at Kennedy could not see him without also seeing a gun firing just 1 inch from his head. Yet nobody did.
In view of the fact that several guns are actually involved, and since the fatal bullet removed from Senator Kennedy's head is so extensively damaged that it cannot be identified as having been fired from any particular gun, the question can reasonably be asked,
which gun fired this fatal bullet? Who killed Robert Kennedy? This question was really never asked, because it was always taken for granted that Sirhan did. The only question ever asked was, why did Sirhan kill Robert Kennedy?
Attorney Godfrey Isaac, who had successfully defended Dr. Noguchi, became involved in this affair and issued this dramatic statement.
A highly respected criminalist has independently investigated the two-gun aspect of the killing of Senator Robert Kennedy, and he has delivered to me for safekeeping an affidavit setting forth his findings. His findings are independent corroboration of the findings of Teddy Chirac in his probe. Among the conclusions he arrived at are the following. One, two .22 caliber guns were involved in the assassination. Two, Senator Kennedy was killed by one of the shots from a firing position behind him. Three, the five surviving victims were wounded by Sirhan shooting from a firing position in front of Senator Kennedy. Finally, he concludes that it is extremely unlikely that any of the bullets fired by the Sirhan gun ever struck the body of Senator Robert Kennedy. It's clear from physical evidence that he has analyzed that his opinion is that there were two gunmen, that there is much to be known here, that the facts are not all in.
The highly respected criminalist referred to by Attorney Isaac is William W. Harper of Pasadena, California. For the past 35 years, Harper has been a consultant in over 300 cases involving firearms, and he is qualified as an expert in both state and federal courts of seven western states.
But I am the only criminalist active in the West Coast who has no affiliation with any law enforcement agency.
Mr. Harper did grant an interview to KHJ-TV and privileged reporter Ted Chirac with some of his preliminary findings, which were broadcast in New York and Los Angeles.
The autopsy report, in combination with the positions of the other victims and the eyewitness account, very strongly established that two 22 caliber revolvers were involved in the assassination. There are two distinct groups of bullet trajectories, roughly 90 degrees apart, in a horizontal plane. One group struck the senator, the other group struck the surviving victims.
Mm-hmm.
A single gun in a brief time interval of a few seconds could not fire both groups of trajectories.
Stunned by Mr. Harper's own findings, Chirac asked him to elaborate on the two groups of trajectories.
Well, the first group, Group A, went in under their right armpit, and they are going upward at a steep angle. And if Kennedy, even if he was up a foot from Kennedy, even if Sirhan was a foot away, he couldn't get his hand and arm pushed around so he could get those upward shots under the armpit. And of course, he was there, he was shooting, he was trying to kill him, but I am very doubtful, I'm still very doubtful that any bullet from Sirhan's gun ever struck the body of the senator.
How can this be explained? Sirhan himself says he was drunk. Author Robert Blair Kaiser suggests that Sirhan may have also been in some kind of hypnotic trance.
The second group, Group B, of five or more shots, were 90 degrees around in front of Kennedy.
Mm-hmm.
And those five shots or more that hit all the people behind Kennedy.
Mr. Harper's interpretation received a solid boost when he was permitted by the Los Angeles County Clerk to examine and photograph the hardcore evidence of the case.
Of course, we know that there was a ballistics man that has participated with Mrs. Blair, who handled them. He brought in other individuals at the time that he examined them, who took photographs, a company that he represented.
Mr. Harper used the brand new Hicon Balliscan camera, which he helped develop at Actron Industries, a subsidiary of McDonnell Douglas. This sophisticated instrument is designed to photograph with precision the bullet grooves and striations used in firearms identification. The bullet under study revolves in front of the lens and leaves a photographic impression of its cylindrical surface on a piece of flat film, somewhat like a tire on a muddy road. Large blow-ups like these are made for comparative study of different bullets. Here we have three precision photographs representing, respectively, the bullet recovered from victim William Wiesel's abdomen, that's Exhibit 54, the bullet removed from Robert Kennedy's neck, that's Exhibit 47, and a test bullet from the mislabeled Exhibit 55. In this simulated demonstration, criminalist William Harper is heard actually pointing out to Chirac the six grooves of Exhibit 47, the bullet removed from Kennedy's neck.
So there's one land impression, or groove, on the bullet. There's two.
Right.
There's three.
Right.
Here's four, five, six, and then we come back to the beginning again.
Why then this notation made on June the 6th, 1968, five grooves, next to the initials DW, Dwayne Woofer, on the lower left front of the envelope containing the Kennedy bullet? This discrepancy alone could mean that two guns were firing in the pantry, or that a bullet substitution took place during the investigation.
How about the other labeling mistake? The five groove on the other exhibit on 47.
You mean how many Dr. Noguchi? Well,
no, Mr. Wolfer initialed that envelope.
No, Dr. Noguchi wrote that there were six lens and grooves, and there was where there should have been five. And I wouldn't.
But it's the other way around, sir.
Well, or five to six, whichever it is. And I wouldn't have an autopsy surgeon being the person who decides how many lens and grooves they are.
It's ridiculous. Ridiculous indeed to destroy this reputation of a scientist and physician. There may be more story to be told than that we know.
Again, Newsmen questioned District Attorney Joseph Bush. First, Ken Krasny of KHJ-TV, who went on to interview criminalist William Harper.
How do you explain the set of photographs that Mr. Harper has produced and which he's testified to in affidavit that show that the bullet from Kennedy's neck and the bullet from William Wiesel don't match, and that neither of those bullets match any of the test bullets that he photographed?
Well, I don't think he said that they don't match any of the test bullets. He said that there are two bullets that he has compared that have rifling angles that are different. And I think if you ask Mr. Harper, that's not an accepted way to make a ballistics comparison.
I can find no matching individual characteristics in common between these two bullets. And in measuring the rifling angle on the bullet removed from Senator Kennedy's neck is 23% greater, or 14% greater, which amounts to about 23 minutes of angle, than the bullet removed from Mr. Wiesel. And since rifling angle is one of the basic class characteristics, I'm forced to conclude that these two bullets were fired by two different guns.
The bullet recovered from Kennedy's neck, Exhibit 47, and the bullet recovered from Wiesel's abdomen, Exhibit 54, just do not match. However, Mr. Harper double-checked. He also compared the Kennedy bullet with a test bullet from Exhibit 55, and they do not match either.
Well, 55-3 is one of the three test slugs in Exhibit 55. I can find no matching individual characteristics that would convince me that the bullet from Kennedy's neck was fired by the same gun that fired this Exhibit 55-3 bullet.
So here we have it, three bullets supposedly fired by Sirhan's gun bearing no resemblance with one another. In addition, even to non-expert eyes, it appears that there are more cannelures, or rings, around the Wiesel bullet than around the Kennedy bullet, which would mean they are two different types of ammunition altogether.
On this matter, Chirac consulted with one of the world's leading criminologists, Professor Herbert Leon McDonnell, director of the Laboratory of Forensic Science in New York. In the sworn affidavit he delivered to Chirac, Professor McDonnell not only confirmed but amplified Mr. Harper's findings.
Well, the mystery actually is that the ammunition found in the Sirhan revolver was all of Omark manufacture, which has two cannelures. The projectile removed from Senator Kennedy had but one.
Well, what about the difference of textures on the surface of the bullet?
The texture, or rifling, actually, is much sharper on the photograph I have seen of the Kennedy bullet than it is on the Wiesel, and this is a gross difference.
So we can say conclusively that there is no doubt that there were not only two different guns, but two different types of ammunition at the scene of the Robert Kennedy assassination.
That is correct. There were different weapons.
Now, what are your conclusions?
My conclusion is that the revolver taken from Sirhan, considering all of the physical factors, could not have been the one that fired the projectile removed from Robert Kennedy.
Are there any photographs on record other than those taken by Mr. Harper?
No, there are not photos of the bullets at the time. You will recall that Mr. Wolfer testified immediately at the grand jury with reference to the Kennedy bullets. And, well, the real examination, ballistics, is done with the human eye and not with photography. And it isn't common to have photographs always made of bullets that have been subject to comparison.
If it were so uncommon, why then would McDonnell Douglas build a special camera for a non-existing market? The fact is that firearm experts make comparison photographs to keep on record and to show the jury how they make their positive identification. But it seems that Mr. Wolfer does not want anyone else to double-check his findings.
Is it necessary to have face marks on matched bullets?
A what?
Necessary.
A what kind of?
Phase mark.
A phase mark? I'm sorry, I don't know what that is.
A phase mark is a dot in India ink that firearms examiners usually put on each of two bullets they have successfully matched, so it'll be easy to match them up again.
I don't know. I suppose they would. It seems logical to me that they would do that.
Seems logical to me, too, but it was not done.
If you refire the gun and the bullets match the bullets that were fired in the pantry that night, then it would seem to put an end to the idea of a second gun.
Yes, but this presumes that there's credible evidence that would require us reopening an investigation and the firing of a gun when we had, there were about 60 witnesses who were in that pantry.
And you've already reopened the investigation.
Yes, but that was to explain the charges that were made against Mr. Wolfer and to ensure the integrity and the public confidence in this case. There is no new evidence that has been brought forth as a result of our investigation that would substantiate any two-gun theory.
From August 16th to August 23rd, 1971, a Los Angeles County grand jury at which Kaiser, Chirac, and Harper testified attempted to discover if the evidence presented at Sirhan's trial had been tampered with after the trial. The deputy district attorney in charge, John Howard, who interrogated Sirhan 2 hours after the crime and stayed on the case all along, opened up with this stunning piece of testimony. Quote, "The gun was an 8-shot revolver, and there were 6 casings inside," which indicates was an outright admission that more than one gun had been fired in the pantry.
I'm wondering how Mr. Howard could make a mistake like that, considering he was in charge of the presentation of the case to the grand jury.
Well, I'm sorry, I can't answer that, but John Howard can, I'm sure.
I just made a mistake. I confused the shells taken out of the pocket with the shells taken out of the gun.
Mr. Howard, now promoted to chief deputy district attorney, corrected himself 2 days later. The grand jury returned no indictment because there was no tampering with the evidence. The county clerk was made a scapegoat for permitting Mr. Harper to examine the bullets. The ground is now laid for a further cover-up, if and when needed.
Well, Mr. Harper's conclusions were very carefully checked, but we found that the evidence that was entered into the trial, after it went to the clerk of the court, was examined by this gentleman and perhaps many other people, and any conclusions he reached about that evidence that was accessible to other people after the trial is of no great moment. I had the pleasure today of handing Mr. Wolfer his certificate of appointment as the chief forensic chemist of the Los Angeles Police Department, and I think that there's no doubt that the courts all around this land who have entertained his testimony and in other countries where he's gathered evidence share my opinion that he is a man who is extremely sound and extremely scientific and extremely qualified, and he doesn't eat and drink with all of the other fellows in the same profession. He's a very independent person, but he is a top-notcher.
Shouldn't the people of Los Angeles have their civil servant, Dwayne Wolfer, point out exactly how he succeeded where apparently William Harper failed? Or must we be satisfied with Mr. Wolfer's explanations of Mr. Wolfer's so-called errors?
There are too damn many things about this that point in one direction, and I think that the Kennedy family should by all means be interested in this, because, hell, the next target will be Ted Kennedy, and then it'll go on down the line. Any of them.
Can you say that the Sirhan matter is now closed as far as you're concerned?
Based on the evidence that we have available to this day, and all the credible evidence that we have, we are satisfied that Sirhan Bashir Sirhan is the murderer of Senator Robert Kennedy, and only he alone is the murderer.
If they get by with this, then you can say that the science of criminalistics was buried when they buried Robert Kennedy. It was buried too.
Now remains the crucial question raised by William Harper's findings. Could one or several other .22-caliber guns be fired in the pantry and remain undetected by the many witnesses present there? Booker Griffin, now news director at KGFJ Radio, told the police, quote, I imagine there must have been about, I'd say, 10 or 12 shots, according to the way I felt. And I just froze there because I felt, you know, to me, I felt there was more than one person. The way it happened, it sounded as if there was more than one gun being used at that point. Unquote. And minutes after the shots were fired, another official witness, Joseph LeHive, had this to say.
I was only like three people behind them, but they all went off with a staccato burst, and it was almost like rapid fire. The guy must have just squeezed them off as fast as he possibly could. And if there were two people, that would account for the seemingly sequence of shots.
Visually, it is obvious that as soon as Sirhan started firing his gun, he became instantly the focal point of all attention. Nobody would have seen another gun, even if it had been drawn in the open. As a matter of fact, there was another gun there, Caesar's. And except for Don Shulman, nobody did notice it. So at the outset, there was no reason to rule out the presence of a second .22 caliber gun firing in the pantry. Another factor to consider is that it's hard to tell at a glance a .22 caliber from a .38. For example, here are two Rhones, the brand Caesar says he was carrying that night. Which is the .38 and which is the .22? Even a .38 should not have been ruled out immediately. After all, in its greatest dimension, the larger flattened fragment removed from the senator's brain during surgery was more than twice the diameter of a .22 caliber slug, and the autopsy did little to clarify this.
We have retrieved a small portion of it.
Dr. Noguchi, can you tell us what caliber it was?
From the fragments that I could not tell.
Therefore, any gun, 22 or 38, should not have been cleared without a close inspection. But the police made no attempt to collect any gun at the scene of the crime. Even Sirhan's gun left the Ambassador Hotel in Rafer Johnson's pocket. And neither the Los Angeles Police Department nor the FBI asked armed guard Thane Eugene Caesar for as much as the caliber of his gun. Not until more than 3 years later. On July 14th, 1971, Caesar was interviewed extensively. He was even asked to undergo a lie detector test, and he accepted. But the polygraph examination was abruptly canceled by the interviewers, with no explanation in the record.
As a substitute, let us compare the two answers Caesar gave to the same question asked by this reporter in 1969 and by the district attorney in 1971.
Did Caesar own a .22 caliber gun the night of the assassination?
Oh, a month after that, I had a little .22, H&R .22, just like the one that was used on Bobby.
Let's hear this again in full context now.
When I got to the police station, I noticed I lost my tie. And I figured, well, I figured when I got knocked down is when it got knocked off. Well, so when they took me back to the hotel, I went into the kitchen area, and the sheriff was still there. It was three or four men there. They were looking for bullets. And because there was I forget how many shots were fired. They asked me how many shots were fired, and I said, well, it sounded like five. But a month after that, I had a little .22, H&R .22, just like the one that was used on Bobby. And I took it out in the woods, had three or four guys with me, and I fired it. It's a 9-shot, and I fired it as fast as I could. And I asked each one of them, I said, how many times did I fire that gun? And not a one of them said over five times. So it's impossible to count how many times you fire a revolver if you pull the trigger fast enough, because you can make two shots sound like one.
What is an H.R. 22?
What is it? It's I can't remember what H&R stands for, but it's exactly the same kind of 22 like he had. Same length barrel, same size. The only difference is that his was an 8-shot and mine's a 9. That's the only difference between the two.
Between what?
Between the 22 Sirhan used and the one I had.
Chirac checked the Harrington and Richardson firearms catalog. Again, he found out that H&R manufactured look-alike 22s and 38s.
And you still have your 22?
No, I don't have the 22 anymore.
You sold it?
I sold it.
When did you sell it?
About a year ago. A friend of mine moving out in the country wanted a little handgun, and I didn't need it, so I sold it to him.
I interviewed Caesar on October the 7th, 1969, as proved by this release signed by Caesar. So he sold the gun in the fall of 68, not somewhere around February 1968, as he told the DA.
Judiciously, Tom Ritt raised this very question when he interviewed author Robert Kaiser on KPFK radio.
In terms of that .22 caliber gun that Caesar ostensibly had prior to the assassination, are there documents that would prove that he in fact sold that gun at the time?
Yes.
I mean, is there a bill of sale extant?
I haven't seen any bill of sale extant. I do know that the district attorney's office has interviewed Caesar, and they've interviewed the man that he sold the gun to, and they're convinced that, in fact, the gun was not even around Los Angeles at that time.
Have you made any attempt to track down that gun?
Yes, we have. It was sold to an individual in Arkansas.
In Arkansas?
Yes.
I called Jim Yoder in Arkansas.
Did you buy a gun from St. Eugene Caesar?
Yes.
When was that, Mr. Yoder?
It was on September 6, 1968, when I sent you the receipt that he gave me. I sent you a photostat copy. I have that receipt now. It says, on the day of September the 6th, 1968, I received $15 from Jim Yoder. He's got it spelled Yoder, Y-O-L-D-E-R. The item involved is a H&R 22 pistol 9 shot serial number. I think that's a Y-1333-2. And then he signed. You got the photostat,
sir. Yes, I sure do.
Mm-hmm.
This bill of sale is authentic. Thane Eugene Caesar's signature matches the one on the release. The date on the bill of sale is September the 6th, 1968, 3 months to the day after Senator Robert Kennedy died.
Did you talk to Thane Caesar during this investigation at all?
Yes, we did.
Did he admit to you that he owned a .22 caliber pistol like Sirhan's?
He did. He said that he sold the revolver that he had, similar to the one that was used in the murder, in February before the shooting occurred.
Are you aware that he told another interviewer that he sold it after the murder occurred?
Well, I can tell you that we've interviewed him and that he sold it before.
Did you have any inquiries regarding that sales receipt?
No, sir, only from you.
Not only Caesar does not want to tell, but apparently District Attorney Bush does not want to find out about the H&R 22 caliber gun. Why?
Unlike Judge Walker, who decided that Sirhan's gun and no other gun was involved, criminalist William Harper thinks that a number of guns cannot be ruled out, and that includes the Ivor Johnson destroyed by the police and Caesar's H&R.
The bullet removed from the neck was related vaguely to the defendant's gun by class characteristics at the time of trial. There was no rigorous proof given that it was fired from the defendant's gun. On the basis of class characteristics only, it could have been fired from many different makes of .22 caliber revolvers, including, of course, another Ivor Johnson or an H&R.
Did Caesar tell you why he wanted to sell his H&R 22?
No. Something came up, and he said he went to the assistance of an officer, or something in that line, let's put it that way.
He seemed a little worried, and he said that there might be repercussions from that. Now, that was, I would say, to the best of my knowledge, sometime in June.
Did he say he fired his gun then?
If I remember correctly, I think he did.
When I asked Mr. Yoder if he still had this gun, he told me it had been stolen from him.
Kaiser accuses Chirac of giving Caesar the bum rap of the year. On the other hand, Chirac clearly demonstrates the plausibility of the second gun, strongly suggested by Harper's findings. To confuse the situation further, the district attorney bars access to the evidence and attacks its physical integrity, thus denying Chirac and Harper a chance to vindicate their claims.
In the case or the event that there would ever be a reversal, it could possibly have some bearing the fact that there may have been some handling and mishandling of exhibits may affect a future trial if that were ever to occur, which we, of course, do not believe will occur.
Whether it was or was not the clerical error, the Supreme Court of the state of California ought not to accept that fact based upon a statement of the district attorney in a press conference.
Would it be unreasonable that a special review board composed of independent criminalists be appointed to settle this controversy?
I don't know where to turn, but to the people. And I ask, please, help to bring the truth out.
The whole truth, nothing but the truth, can emerge from the pandemonium of June the 5th, 1968. Simple justice demands that the truth be demonstrated beyond the shadow of a doubt.
We tried to
answer all the questions and eliminate all doubts. And I think we did, and the jury apparently agreed.
The first thing I said when Senator Kennedy was killed, when he was shot, was that we are not going to have another Dallas here. And so that is the reason that we handled this in the very, very careful fashion that it was handled. This thing got probably 100 times the care that the typical homicide would get.
The people in delegating authority do not give their public servants the right to decide what is good for the people to know and what is not good for them to know. The people should insist on remaining informed so that they may retain control over the instruments which they have created.
We are the masters, not the subjects, of our government. It will recognize with Sophocles that all men make mistakes, but that a good man yields when he knows his course is wrong, and then he repairs the error, and that the only sin is pride.
Prophetic words, written 5 centuries before Christ, in Greece, where democracy and tragedy were born. Spoken by Robert Francis Kennedy 5 years before Watergate. Democracy has endured, and also tragedy.